Namaskar, good afternoon. I welcome the August gathering to the 59th edition of the prestigious Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Memorial Lecture, a tradition that goes back all the way to 1955. The esteemed speaker for the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture 2016 is Dr. Jitendra Singh, eminent intellectual and political luminary. Dr. Jitendra Singh resigned from the eminent position of Professor of Medicine and Endocrinology upon being elected to the 16th Lok Sabha from the Udhampur constituency in the state of Jammu and Kashmir in 2014. As Professor of Diabetes and Endocrinology, he has been invited as faculty to all the major national, international, and South Asian diabetes conferences. He has authored 5 books, 5 monograms, over 5,000 published articles in the press, including the widely syndicated column, Tales of Travesty. He was the first ever medical professional to be conferred the coveted Jamna Devi Gyan Devi Award. Dr. Singh has been a member in his capacity as an advisor and executive of many research committees and boards at national and international levels, focused on diabetes and endocrinology. We are honored to have amidst us our chief guest, Colonel Rajyavardhan Rathore, one of the brightest young stars in the contemporary political firmament. Our guest of honor, Dr. A. Surya Prakash, Chairman, Prasar Bharati Board. Sri Suresh Chandra Panda, Member Personnel, Prasar Bharati. Sri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance, Prasar Bharati. Director General Doordarshan, Srimati Supriya Sahu, the Director General, AIR News, Doordarshan News. The Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture is an annual feature organized by All India Radio in memory of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Known as the Iron Man of India, Sardar Patel was one of the key integrating forces of the nascent nation and was an integral part of India's independence movement. Every year, we commemorate the birth anniversary of this stalwart, who was also Free India's first Minister of Information and Broadcasting, with a nationwide broadcast of the recording of this lecture. Designed to contribute to the existing knowledge on a given subject and to promote awareness on contemporary issues. Over the years, the lectures have become a repository of valuable knowledge for those seeking to understand India. Eminent persons from various fields have, with their intellectual contribution, helped make the series almost a national institution. The series began in 1955 with a lecture by Sri Chakravarti Raja Gopalachari. The list of speakers is a veritable who's who, with names like Dr. K.S. Krishnan, Dr. Zakir Hussain, Sri Morarji Desai, Dr. Romila Thapar, Professor M.G.K. Menon, Sri Jagmohan, Sri L.K. Jha, Swami Ranganathananda, Dr. Karan Singh, Dr. S.Z. Kasim, Dr. A.P.J. Abdul Kalam, Sri Somnath Chatterjee, Hamid Ansari, and Sri Arun Jaitley. Today, we have with us the eminent intellectual and political analyst, Dr. Jitendra Singh, for the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture 2016, and the topic is Cooperative Federalism, Reconciling Regional Aspiration and National Cohesion. I will now request the Director General All India Radio, Sri F. Sheriar, to deliver the welcome address.
Honorable Union Minister for Information and Broadcasting, Colonel Rajyavardhan Singh Rathore. Respected Jitendra Singh Ji, today's distinguished speaker, Dr. A. Surya Prakash, Chairman Prasar Bharati, members of Prasar Bharati, Mr. Suresh Chandra Panda, and Mr. Rajiv Singh, my colleagues from All India Radio and Doordarshan, and discerning listeners that have gathered here today. A great privilege indeed, and no less a pleasure to welcome you all for today's Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture. All India Radio organizes it every year in memory of Sardar Patel, a veritable colossus and a great visionary who had national cohesion uppermost in his mind. The subject chosen for the lecture today is Cooperative Federalism, Reconciling Regional Aspirations and National Cohesion. Sardar Patel steadfastly and single-handedly strived for unification, bringing all the princely states into the Indian mainstream with characteristic grit and determination. Is the sporadic trend of rising regional aspirations necessarily a threat to cooperative federalism? This appears to be not a rhetorical question, but a puzzle to ponder over. One wonders, has the demand for bifurcation of states been a reflection of lopsided development or regional disparities? There are many such questions that strike one's imagination. Let's ponder. It's an old adage that no chain is stronger than its weakest link. If regional aspirations lead to strengthening of every link in the chain, what is wrong about it? And what is the role of regional parties? The opportunity offered by today's memorial lecture, we believe, will enlighten us about the fascinating concept of cooperative federalism in the context of India. AIR is singularly fortunate that a penetrating thinker like Dr. Jitendra Singh has agreed to expatiate on this special theme, perhaps relevant to today's socio-political milieu. I'm sure his erudite exposition will be an accelerating and enriching experience to all of us, and also to the multitude of listeners that would hear this lecture over All India Radio on 31st of October, 2016, on our national hookup at 10 in the night. On behalf of Prasar Bharati, especially its chairman and board members, I once again extend a warm and hearty welcome to all of you, the distinguished personalities on the dais, and those in the audience. I leave the microphone for my colleague, Ms. Basudha Banerjee, to carry forward the proceedings. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now request the dignitaries to offer Pushpanjali, floral tributes to the portrait of Sardar Patel. I will now call upon Dr. A. Surya Prakash, Chairman Prasar Bharati, who has been in the media industry with a conspicuous presence for the past over 3.5 decades. Dr. A. Surya Prakash has contributed to the media landscape of India substantially and creditably and earned himself accolades in and outside India. Dr. A. Surya Prakash, who is at the helm of the public service broadcaster, is requested to felicitate with bouquets and shawls both the union ministers who have so generously taken time out to adorn the dais today. Sir. Flowers are love's truest language, and woven into the warp and weft of the shawl is our reference. Mr. Chairman, sir, kindly do the honors for the speaker of the 59th edition of the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture, Dr. Jitendra Singh. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, sir. And now, the same tokens of love and reverence for our chief guest, the young and dynamic Union Minister for Information and Broadcasting, Colonel Rajyavardhan Rathore. Thank you once again, Chairman, sir. May I now request the Director General of All India Radio, Shri F. Shahryar, to felicitate with flowers Shri Suresh Chandra Panda, Member Personal Prasar Bharati, Shri Rajiv Singh, Member Finance Prasar Bharati, and Shri Sunil Arora, former Secretary Information and Broadcasting, currently Advisor Prasar Bharati. I will need three bouquets, three. For our guest of honor, Chairman Prasar Bharati, Shri A. Surya Prakash. Arora Sahib. We now invite our esteemed speaker of this afternoon's function, Dr. Jitendra Singh, to deliver the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture 2016 on the topic Cooperative Federalism, Reconciling Regional Aspiration and National Cohesion. Sir, the podium is yours.
Thank you very much. Seated on the dais, Union Minister for Information and Broadcasting and our very dear friend, Colonel Rajavardhan Rathaurji, Shri Surya Prakash ji, Rajiv ji, Panda ji, seated in front of me, a very esteemed friend and our academic sibling, Tarun Vijay ji, Sunil Arora ji, and of course, the man behind the show and who actually is responsible for having made me stand before you, our friend and Director General AIR, Faiz Shahryar Saab. At the outset, I have to thank you for having given me this opportunity to share some of my thoughts and also to learn from you and from this audience of highly enlightened and literate gentlemen and gentleladies. I look forward to this as a very educative experience, and I'm sure when I go back from here at the end of this brief program, I shall go back wiser than before. I must admit at the outset that when Faiz Shahryar suggested to me that I could be a speaker, I was rather honestly speaking taken aback, because I do not think my profile is in keeping with these kind of lectures, though I have been a lecturer all my life. But I was never a student of commerce, finance, political science. All my life a student of science, and that too medical science. But yes, this happens. When I came into the government, I was assigned to deal with atomic energy and space, so I had to start learning physics from ABC, because I had, as a medical student, given up physics after class 10, and then at the most we were taught only chemistry or biochemistry. And therefore, to an extent, I'm also grateful to Faiz Shahryar that he forced me into a position where I had to sit down and learn some of the nuances of cooperative federalism, the financial aspects of it, and the political nuances of it. I also feel humbled by the list of the persons that was just spoken out who have been associated with this memorial lecture. C. Rajgopalachari, I know how many of us would recall that once long back there was a book written by Natwar Singh where he referred to a foreign commentator who said Rajgopalachari was one person who could be head of state in any part of the world. So it's a very tough job and a big responsibility to take a dais which was initiated by Rajaji, as he was affectionately called. And also a great honor to be associated with the name of Sardar Vallabhai Patel, whom all of us remember and respect as a person who was responsible for having brought over 565 princely states into the Indian Union and given the Indian Union the kind of format that it exists. And I think nobody else can understand the importance of this better than someone like me who comes from Jammu and Kashmir, about which they said that had Sardar Patel also been given a free hand to deal with Jammu and Kashmir, the course of events would have been different. But we would not go into that because that's an issue for a separate lecture and a separate seminar. And incidentally, this also happens to be the accession week of Jammu and Kashmir. So therefore, coming directly to the subject assigned to me this morning, I also have to thank for the kind introduction before I start. I think it was a little overstatement by Fiaz when he said intellectual. I myself am not aware what is the definition of intellectual. At least, I hope he is not putting us in the class of those award vapsi wale intellectual. But nevertheless, we are not intellectuals, but we are thinkers. We keep bothering ourselves and bothering others with certain whatever comes to our mind and then try to learn each moment, each day of our life. The lecture of mine has already been circulated. I'm not sure whether you would have gone through that. And therefore, I would not bother you with reading out the entire script of it, because I trust the wisdom of this august audience. I will just like to dwell on some of the salient features or some of the points which might be coming to me randomly and which might have come to me during the course of these few minutes when I was listening to others. Because sometimes the circulated text loses its entirety when the discussion starts. I remember soon after I came back from my post-graduation and MD, and I was yet to be posted, I was asked to report to the Rashtrapati Bhavan to be in the long queue of doctors which accompanies the president wherever he goes. And the president incidentally was Gyani Dayal Singh Ji. So I was the last in the queue as a young boy. I had nothing to do, just to watch from the wings. And we had to go to a university for a convocation. And when Gyani Ji came on the dais, as was his individual style, he said, "Wo takreer to taqseem ho gayi hai." So it can be assumed to have been read. If that be so, Fiasa, my job is over and we can go for tea. So Gyani Ji ne kaha, "Nahi, sirf ek minute ruk jaiye, panna number 9 palatiye." So everybody started doing that. इसका जो तीसरा पैरा है आखिर में वो ना पढ़िएगा, वो गलत हो गया, बाकी पढ़ लीजिएगा. एंड देन वी कैन डिस्पर्स. सो लाइक एज यू आस्क अ बॉय नॉट टू चाइल्ड नॉट टू डू समथिंग यू डिलीवर यू, एवरीबडी स्टार्टेड रीडिंग व्हाट इट वाज. एंड देन ज्ञानी जी सेड कि मैंने अपने सेक्रेटरी से कहा था कि मेरी तकरीर में महिला शिक्षा पर थोड़ा बल देना, परंतु यहाँ क्या हुआ कि PhD की सारी डिग्रियाँ बालिकाओं को ही मिली, महिलाओं को, तो ये थोड़ा पैरा गलत हो गया. So this is an opportunity also to correct what is being written in the text already. But having said that, I would say I would rather go outside the text and try to dwell on some of the random thoughts that occur to me while being here or while on my way to this venue or when Fiaz Saab asked me to dwell on this subject. The first thought that came to my mind was, because I had never actually dealt with this subject very seriously, because I never called to do so, I said, what would be the ideal definition of cooperative federalism in general? Maybe the subject was assigned to me in a certain context, the certain context of a certain nation or certain milieu. But otherwise, would it not be a natural instinct for any species, a human species or a society or a nation, to have a natural urge to live in an atmosphere of cooperation and coexistence? So would it not be something which should be coming naturally to every living being? If we do not get entrapped in the conditioning of the socio-political milieu in which the subject has been allotted. The same thought occurred to me in the beginning of this year when I was asked to speak on World Brotherhood Day to mark the day of Swami Vivekananda. And since sometimes the lectures are so much piled up that you get a time to think over it only when you are driving to the place. So the moment I reached there, I said the first thought came to me, why should we have a discussion on brotherhood? Are we not brothers otherwise? Kauwa kauwe ka bhai, kutta kutte ka bhai, saamp saamp ka bhai. And do we have to remind ourselves that a human being is a human being's brother and he ought to live in a state of cooperation and a federalist coexistence? And then suddenly that occurred to me and I told them, I said, in college, we'd come across a verse by Ghalib, and we dismissed it. कि भाई गालिब तो कभी फलसफाना अंदाज में लिखते थे, कभी रोमानियत में, कभी दोनों मिक्स हो जाता था. But now I realize how much beyond times he had thought when he wrote कि बस के दुश्वार है हर काम का आसान होना, आदमी को भी मयसर नहीं इंसान होना. So it's not every individual's privilege and destiny to become a human being. If we had, then we possibly didn't have to debate on these subjects of living in cooperation or in coexistence. But be that as it may, as long as we do not evolve to that level of realization, possibly we need to have some kind of regulation for ourselves, some kind of law for ourselves, some kind of legislation for ourselves, some kind of binding for ourselves, some kind of a written dictum for ourselves. As Voltaire once said that if you don't have God, you might have to invent one. Ki aapko dar laga rahe, koi dekh raha hai upar se, to discipline yourself. And therefore, maybe we have to make it a part of the rule book that there's something called cooperative federalism, which I don't think should be also taken otherwise, because for a democracy like India, we are very young. We are just about 70 years. In the age of an individual, this appears to be a long lifespan, because when you are 50, 60, 70, and you subconsciously begin to realize, though you hate to believe, that your time is also coming to an end, and then you start thinking of so many things, ki jab nikle the to ye karne ko socha tha, ab sara kuch reh gaya. But in the life of a nation, the lifespan is measured in centuries, in eras, yugo mein. And therefore, this is even a small fraction. And therefore, we are still evolving to a level where maybe the older democracies have already evolved, and they might have lost the relevance of discussing these subjects. And therefore, our founding fathers, considering the kind of stage of infancy that Indian democracy was, were of course visionaries, all of them in their own right, and they gave us a constitution which gave us this concept of a federation. But they did not consciously give it the nomenclature of a federal state, maybe considering the requirements at that time. Maybe they might have thought that we were still to evolve over a period of time to a stage where other federal states or nations including United States had already evolved. And therefore, I can, without being modest, take credit in saying that it was destined for this government and Prime Minister Modi to revisit the entire concept of federalism and give it the nomenclature of cooperative federalism and try to understand how best to go about with it. And to that extent, I can also say that just as Nehru's midnight arrival heralded a new era for India, when he said, when the entire world sleeps, India wakes, at the midnight of 1415. The twilight arrival of Narendra Modi at 6 p.m. on the 26th of May 2014, as I always say, could be described as a sunrise at sunset. Also because physically and literally it happened that all the television sets across the world got lit up. And there was so much light, it is virtually like a sunrise happening. And that marked the beginning of a new era. And maybe it was destined for a prime minister of this era and a government of this era to seek to revisit this subject, because I am trying to confine myself to the relevance of the contemporary context. Otherwise, we can go on and on. And certainly, therefore, it would also be a compliment to the Prime Minister's vision and his insight, and also to the evolving new nuances and requirements of a 70-year-old nation. On the physical part, I think the three historic steps taken by this government, without sounding to be a government spokesman, which I am not officially as well. The setting up of Niti Aayog is one. We may sometimes, out of cynicism or out of our tendency to be a little skeptic about everything new, take time to believe. But I'm sure generations will recall it. Niti Aayog, and second, the devaluation of taxes, and third, the creation of an atmosphere for the introduction of GST, would be some of the measures, the impact of which would be realized on a larger canvas in the years to come, and which would form an inherent part of what we describe as cooperative federalism in the modern times and era, where the economic constraints and economic realizations predominate over everything else. As far as the Niti Aayog is concerned, it had been realized for several years now. Many of the opinion makers had written. There were also write-ups appearing from time to time that Planning Commission had possibly disgraced its earlier role, which is without challenging the wisdom of those who had established it, because maybe it was required at that time. The nuances changed, the times changed. When Fayaz Shahriar was saying that my lecture, this one, will be broadcast at 10 p.m. on 31st, instead of being flattered, I felt depressed. Because that is the time everybody is watching television debates and hardly anybody listening to radio. But once upon a time, about quarter century ago, this was the prime time, and I myself was closely associated as an AI drama artist, and this was the time reserved for the national plays. But we have to change, and I think, Fayaz Sahab, you will have to do me a favor to rebroadcast it sometime around 11 o'clock in the forenoon. So that people can listen to it when they are driving to their offices. And therefore, coming back to what I was saying, without challenging the wisdom of those who would have set up Planning Commission, it was being realized that the times had changed, and Planning Commission had possibly disgraced its role of primarily being a think tank. And there was also opinion coming from the states that, at least in the economic part, the routing of grants in aid was being managed by the Planning Commission more than it should have. And therefore, the reincarnation of this commission in the form of Niti Aayog was meant to encourage more of cooperation in the among the various federal states through a structured initiative or a structured sport, I would say, and B, to accommodate the diverse opinions of the various states and also to deepen their engagement in the affairs of the nation, the affairs of the state, which I think nobody could have understood better than someone like Narendra Modi, who had himself been a chief minister, with the center being run by a different party for almost 15 years. And therefore, Niti Aayog also paved the way for the formation of a governing council, which, unlike in the Planning Commission, included the chief ministers, the governors, the administrators of the various union territories, and therefore gave it a greater leverage for comradeship, for participation. And then went beyond that to form subgroups. Now we have subgroups on some of the flagship programs headed by certain chief ministers, certain governors, like, for example, you have one for the Swachh Bharat. So the decision making and the conclusion making was not entirely left to the center. And a beginning has been made, which is, of course, too early. It will evolve as we move ahead. The second important decision, I think, which would also go in with the endeavor for promoting this federalism through mutual cooperation is the arriving at a consensus to bring about the GST. The mere slogan of one nation, one tax itself carries a lot of symbolic significance. It tends to bind us in a single cord. And of course, it is a provision to provide a unified common national market by integrating the various taxes by the center and state, as we all know, taxes as well as levies. And there too, for decision making, we have a GST council, of which all the finance ministers of the different respective states are members, with the union finance minister being its head. So again, it is not left to the center. And if you are not ready to believe instantly to the intentions of the government or the intentions of the makers of this concept, because we live in an era of evidence and we go by statistics and data, I think you would agree that the decision making has also been made statistical in GST Council. For any decision to be ratified, you need to have 3/4 of majority. And the vote share of the center is only 1/3, and that of the states is 2/3. So 1/3 vote of the center alone cannot also force a decision, nor can the 2/3 vote of state alone. So unless center and the states come on the same page, willingly or unwillingly, happily or unhappily, agreeing or disagreeing, no decision would happen. So I think that should also be a reflection of the sincerity and the intention that has gone behind this. And the third aspect, as I said, in keeping with this concept, was the acceptance of the 14th Finance Commission, leading on to an increase in the divisible pool of taxes from 32% to 42%. An earlier complaint was that the devolution of the divisible pool was accompanied by the reduction in the center's aid in grant. But in the last few months that this has been practiced, again going to the figures and statistics, the report is that not only there has been increased resources on the part of the states, there also rise in the capital expenditure. And as many I have in this lecture mentioned the data, statistics and the tables, 26 states of the country have recorded a rise in their total quantum. And therefore, we have statistical reason to believe that even if it was an experiment to begin with, when we did so a year or so back, it was an experiment in the right direction. I would rather, maybe the format of this lecture does not encourage much of interaction, but we could have so afterwards, because that will be more fruitful. And therefore, without going much into what has already been written by me, because I have given the range-wise, how many states have benefited from 10 to 15%, how many from 15 to 20%, how many more than that. And in all, it is about 26 states. But beyond this economic aspect of it, and also the cooperative federalism, as is the title of the lecture assigned to me, I would, if you permit me, also add to it another term, that is of competitive federalism. And I think this kind of a healthy milieu of mutual cooperation in a healthy and a positive spirit also paves the way for a healthy competition, which in turn enables the individual states as well as the center to improve upon themselves at different levels. And going beyond this, I would say that if this experiment of cooperative federalism helps us to grow in the arena of competitive federalism and to become better than what we are as individual states and the center, this is going to be again a unique experiment in a democratic practice. And this might also be a reflection of Indian democracy coming of age. And this might be an experiment which could be emulated in other spheres of our activity as well. And therefore, I would in the end say that politically and socially, there is also a vindication of sorts for those of us who are part of this government. When this government was sworn in on the evening of 26th, the immediate reaction, because we are still evolving to that genre of specialized journalism, as we have in West, we have different sets, genre of economic journalists, different genre of war journalists. We in India still have majority of them as general journalists, which see through the prism of politics. And the immediate criticism that was forthcoming was that this was a government and this was a prime minister with a huge mandate and a huge majority, and therefore, leave aside cooperative federalism, there will be no federalism at all. And this will be an authoritarian government. And there was so much of apprehension and bias, and people had already started looking at some of the critic friends of ours. And as someone who's also MOS and PMO, a question often asked was, don't you think PMO has become authoritarian? And my standard answer would be no, PMO has become PMO, which it was not for the last 10 years. Because the authority was being exercised from another quarter and the nation forgot what PMO is like. So I think with the kind of statistics and data which I have tried to place before you and also included in this book is also a kind of vindication of the fact that the Prime Minister is a Democrat and has also lived up to the government's commitment of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, because this cooperative federalism is in fact also an inspiration of the philosophy of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, and a capacity to accommodate diversities in a country as heterogeneous as India, and also realizing the dream of our founding fathers to usher in an era of peaceful, uniform growth for all, which I'm sure must have been the dream of our founding fathers, and the founding fathers of the nation as well as the founding fathers of the Constitution. And to that extent, I think it would be reasonable to say that cooperative federalism, though as it sounds to be in our context and is often discussed in the contemporary context of India, is discussed more often than not, and maybe rightly so, in economic and financial terms, sometimes also in the political jargon. But I think in the long run, it would serve the purpose of proving to be a psychological binder between the among the different units of Indian Republic, the states, the union territories, the states, and the three-tier system of the central state and the local bodies. It will give us also a sense of belonging, a feeling of comradeship, and above all, the confidence of being equal partners in the development of nation and development of the individual states. We are in a very initial phase of this experiment, but the statistics are encouraging. And I'm sure history will record this as a path-breaking initiative, both of Prime Minister Modi and both of this government. And cooperative federalism, because the history of nations is written in eras. You have the before independence, you had pre-war era, post-war era relating to World War, then you have pre-independence, you have post-independence, and I'm sure when the history is written, there will be at least one chapter on the Modi era as well. And this would go down as a Modi doctrine when it gains wider acceptability. I am sure what has been written and stated before you would give you a cue for thought and would also enable us to receive some more valuable cues to improve upon this initiative and to improve upon the concepts that this government is trying to commit itself. Thank you very much once again.
We are indeed grateful to you, Honorable Minister Sir, for that engaging and illuminating lecture. As the Honorable Speaker has expressed a desire for questions, maybe we will take a few, three or four. The questions have to be confined to the subjects of the lecture, please. In case the audience has any questions to ask, you are free to ask. Maybe we will take 3 to 4 questions and then the distinguished minister will answer them altogether. Do we have any questions? Microphone. Do we have a microphone?
No, I'm glad that Tarunji has asked this question. This is something which I could have wished to speak about, but then at the risk of deviating from the subject as such, but certainly this deserves thought, and I'm glad that you put it up. As I said, 70 years is not too much of a life in the history of a nation, and therefore we are still an evolving democracy, an evolving society, and we still have a huge degree of feudalism. And that also reflects in some of our political parties and our political activities. I remember, though I don't know whether I have to say that as a minister, but once in somewhere in late 50s, the Independent newspaper, because Tarunji is himself an eminent journalist, once wrote that India does not have a prime minister, it has an emperor prime minister. Because it was a foregone conclusion that we would always elect the same prime minister. And therefore, it was written that you have an emperor prime minister for life. And during Nehru's time, the question was not of replacing him. The question was, after Nehru, who? And that was a book which became a bestseller. So for a nation which had been conditioned to be ruled by monarchy in one manner or the other, whether it was the Britishers or the others or other dynasties, it is not unusual to have taken about quarter century or even longer, or maybe nearly half a century, to come out of that feudal conditioning, which was reflecting in our democracy as well. We were getting carried away by symbols. But you must have realized in the last few years that people have come of age, the voter has come of age, the youth has come of age. And I think there are two main pointers to this. A, that India today, India of 2016, has 65 to 70% of population which is below the age of 35 to 40. So they are not ready to take the conditioning of their parents. They are even ready to defy the parents. B, the politicians, I always say, is not come of age as fast as the common man. The common man, the common youth of this country is growing faster than the politicians. When I go for the election, I try the tricks of the last election to woo the voter, quite unmindful of the fact that the voter has moved ahead, particularly because I have now a large chunk of new youth voters who have got included. So this is what I was telling my workers also in the constituency. So certainly things would change, and it is evolving. We have certainly evolved to a level where the dynasties are not that overwhelming in our psyche, and we are more democratic. That is reflecting. And as I said, cooperative federalism is something which might have started by this government in the canvas where the government had a prerogative to function, because it could function only in the realms of Planning Commission and Niti Aayog. But ultimately, this experiment is going to have a reflection on the society as well. It will herald the coming of age of a democracy, coming of age of society, and it has already started reflecting in your families. Many of the parents sitting here would bear me out. Your child refuses to agree with you. You have to either convince him or you have your own way. And I think that kind of thing is now emerging. So that kind of, and that is why in the beginning I said, should this not come naturally? This instinct of cooperation, the instinct of coexistence, if it happens naturally, it will happen at every level. Because it was not there at the dawn of independence, we had to regimentalize it. But I certainly agree with you, absolutely.
Patel, but the greatest memorial to him is United India itself. Through his persuasive power, diplomatic skills, political adroitness, he was able to bring about administrative unification of this country, which is the essential basic apparatus for building a strong India. This administrative unification has to be transformed into an emotional integration and national cohesion, unquote. To honor this apostle of national cohesion, the government of India declared that his birthday on 31st October will be observed as the Rashtriya Ekta Divas. We have amidst us Colonel Rajyavardhan Singh Rathore, Honorable Minister, and an outstanding speaker to shed light on the significance of Rashtriya Ekta Divas.
Morning, ladies and gentlemen. They say that victory is only vital in surgeries and war, and a government that prefers surgeries over war, they're bound to be doctors in the government and soldiers in the government as well. Thank you so much, Dr. Jitendra Singh Ji, who's Union Minister of State, Independent Charge for Development of Northeastern Region, MOS, PMO, and of course he has departments, personnel, public grievances, pension, Department of Atomic Energy, Space. He's also a specialist in diabetics, columnist, has written 8 books. Thank you so much for delivering this lecture, which is a great tradition, with All India Radio and with our country to have Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel lecture. Thank you also to Jay Prakash Ji, Panda Ji, Rajiv Ji, Sharia Ji for conducting this. We have Mr. Sunil Arora here sitting with us. We have DGs of various media units, eminent guests are here, friends from the media are here, young students who are here with us as well. 31st October is an Ekta Devas for the entire country. From 31st October to 5th of November, we will celebrate a National Unity Week in the memory of Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel. It's important to remember true icons, true leaders, not just to celebrate them, but also when you celebrate and remember such true leaders, you actually encourage more such people like that. And with the potential that India has, with the patriotism that is there in India, with the domination that India now has in the whole world, I'm sure when we remember people like Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel, we will have many more people like him. There are a few things about Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel that attract me. Of course, he was born in 1875, married pretty young. He had his share of troubles. He wanted to become a barrister. He accumulated money to become a barrister, but then gave it to his brother because his brother wanted to become a barrister first. That's quite unusual in families that go through tough times for a person to really sacrifice at that age. But he had his determination, he remembered his goal in his life, and he went on to become barrister. He went, studied in England, and he came back as a barrister. At a time when he came back, Mahatma Gandhi was already in our country. He'd come back from South Africa. And as a practicing barrister in Gujarat Club, Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel happened to hear the speech of Mahatma Gandhi. And that moved him, that perhaps inspired him to do something what Mahatma was doing. He waited for a couple of more years, and after another satyagraha that Mahatma Gandhi took, he then joined him. He gave up his Western clothing. He started wearing the dhoti and the khadis and joined Mahatma Gandhi in his endeavor to free India. Once he took on the political life, he took part in various satyagrahas. He became a counselor in Ahmedabad, stayed on as a counselor for about 10 years. And perhaps at that time, he started the Swachhta Abhiyan in Ahmedabad. And he could actually be called as the father of all Swachhta Abhiyans. He himself took to the broom. He started from the Harijan Basti, from the Dalit colony there. And he did this repeatedly to set about an atmosphere of cleanliness. He stayed as a counselor for 10 years, like I said, became the president as well there. And then he got greater responsibilities. It was in one of the satyagrahas in Bardoli that he was named as Hamara Sardar by the kisans who were there. And that upadhi, that stuck with him throughout his life, being called the Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel. Once he got the responsibility as in the elected government, he became the first deputy prime minister. He became the first home minister. And I can proudly say that he also became the first information broadcasting minister of the country.
Also DOPT. DOPT was part of home ministry at that time.
Yeah, he had the department of DOPT as well with him. That's news to me. With all those responsibilities, I think there were two critical things that he did. One, when Kashmir was attacked in October 1947, he, along with Sardar Baldev Singh, who was then the Raksha Mantri, landed in Srinagar Airport on the 4th of November. Now, that was the time when the tribal Pashtuns were nearly as close to Srinagar Airport that the landings actually took place with great difficulty. He managed to land there in such an environment. He took a briefing from the brigadier who was posted there, Brigadier LP Sen, flew back to Delhi, organized the armed army, sent in reinforcements there, and to a very large extent managed to push back the militia that had come across from Pakistan. And he literally saved Kashmir. The point to highlight here is at that point of time, Prime Minister Nehru was also being briefed by one of the brigadiers in the army. And the Prime Minister felt the situation was normal. And so that's the catch there, that the Home Minister was able to understand the situation, was able to go to a war scenario himself, exposing himself to the dangers, assess the situation, what actually existed, take the field decisions that were important for the country, and send in the reinforcements in time to save Kashmir. Not just that, he also reconnected Srinagar with Jammu, with the telecommunications, telegraph that time, wireless, roads, connection of bridges. He also moved the Maharaja's family to Jammu and re-established Kashmir. His second most important, what he did for the country was 565 princely states. Unification of so many princely states is not an easy task. And at a time when you can imagine just one state can create a problem that exists till today, just imagine what 565 could have done. Just imagine about 100 Kashmirs in India. Or imagine independent states within the territory of India. And how much trouble can they cause? With coercion, with diplomacy, sometimes with police action. Within about a year to 2 years, he managed to unite all the 565 princely states. He also established the Indian Information System, Indian Information Service, which is till date serving the whole country. And for this entire task that he had done, for 30 years that he had served the country, surprisingly, there is no memorial for him in our country. Perhaps it's only this government that has come in and introduced all the great work that Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel had done for this country. And that is why we will remember him for this entire week from 31st October to 5th November, so that we not only just celebrate him, but we create many more Sardars in our country. Thank you so much.
Iron Man of India. Ladies and gentlemen, you have taken time out today to be with us at the National Media Center and make our program a success. To offer our gratitude to you formally, I request Mrs. Aparna Vaish, Additional Director General of All India Radio, to deliver the vote of thanks. Ma'am.
Thank you, Jitendra Singh Ji, for your very valuable thoughts on cooperative federalism. I am Naz Azhar from UNI. You said one era began with Jawaharlal Nehru, and another era in India's history began with Prime Minister Modi. I would like to know, of course, some of the policies practiced by Nehru were conditioned by the situation prevailing just after independence. So I would like to know, what are some of the elements that you would like to carry forward? Of course, there might have been negative and positive both in what Nehru did, but do you see anything which can be carried forward even today?
It's a politically, it's a very naughty question. But coming from a friend and a colleague, see, that will actually be another subject of discussion. But I have no hesitation to say that maybe given that time and age, one very distinct feature, of course, as far as the foreign policy is concerned, because Nehru thought bigger than India and he had that kind of a persona. But time unfortunately proved him wrong, because as I said, I would not say anything without facts. For example, just to cite two examples, the example of Peer Panchal and the Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai. The experiment failed in his own lifetime and unfortunately also weighed on him. The second was of the non-aligned movement. I've just come back from Belgrade, where actually it originated, with Marshal Tito having headed the first meeting there. Within less than 10 years of Nehru's passing away, Indiraji had to enter into an Indo-Soviet accord. It was not even 10 years before Nehru had passed away, because there was that 7th fleet coming over and the US threat. So India was constrained to ally with one side or the other. So I think the foreign policy, which Nehruji thought was his, you know, specialty, also did not. But that, of course, does not deny his other virtues of being an excellent orator and an excellent author and a statesman in his own right. But, and of course, Jammu Kashmir, as Colonel Saab was saying, and I didn't want to go into that because that will make a separate story, a rather more juicy story. But the common opinion is that the course of events would have been different if Sardar Patel was given the liberty to handle, like other states, Jammu Kashmir as well, because Nehru believed that he knew Jammu Kashmir better than Sardar Sahab, and therefore he should take care of it. And then going to UNO and all those things are part of the history right now. Even though, to put the record straight, whenever we are in a debate, we don't have to be defensive, because that UN resolution itself was not against accession of Jammu and Kashmir with India, it was against aggression of Pakistan against India. So that is one point which should be technically correct whenever we go for the 9 o'clock debate. The second part is that, I mean, that is what I was sharing with my spokespersons of the party also. The second part is that the resolution itself became infructuous, because one of the conditions was that Pakistan also has to withdraw from its occupied territory, which it refused to. But nevertheless, it gave an opportunity for the other school of thought to say that Jammu and Kashmir was something which could be discussed internationally and even at UNO, which officially we don't believe. Personally, I don't believe. We have no such issue as Jammu and Kashmir. It's an integral part of India. It always was. If at all there's an issue, it is only how to retrieve back the part of Jammu and Kashmir which continues to be under the illegal occupation of Pakistan. So I think there are a number of things for which maybe Nehru did not foresee, and we are still trying to handle that. But most distinctive feature, without sounding modest, I would say, no doubt when Nehru went abroad, he was received with great applause. But I was saying this while talking to one of my friends overseas. I said Nehru was seen more as a foreigner, even in UK, who had lived there from the age of 7 and more of an Englishman than a local Englishman. He could tell them the names of all the perfumes, the scents and wines more than the locals. But it is for the first time in the history of independent India that Modi is being hailed as a prime minister from an India and an India's prime minister and an Indian prime minister. So that is something, a big achievement. And that also is a reflection of coming of age of the Indian democracy. We have a prime minister who is seen as a prime minister who is risen from the roots of India, who is seen as an Indian and as a prime minister. So we don't have to take alibi in having a prime minister who was recognized abroad for other reasons than being an Indian.
But you said Sardar Patel brought in all the princely states and created a federal structure and a union of India. Now, looking at the regional aspirations, we have several regional parties, and those number of those regional parties are increasing. And all these regional parties are ruled, governed, and owned by, you know, individuals and families who are kind of kings and queens and, you know, prince themselves. And this is increasing. So do you think these regional princely parties, you know, who are, you know, kind of ruling many states and the numbers are increasing, will become in future a threat to the federalism and union of India?
No, I'm glad.
Is there any solution to it?
No, I'm glad this is a question which is often comes into discussion, and Fiaz Saab also in his introductory remarks had hinted at that. I did not dwell into that because I thought it'll, you know, go into a different direction. But there are two aspects to it. For a country like India, which is in fact a subcontinent, and that's why we call it Indian subcontinent, and which is as heterogeneous as India, and that is in fact, you know, the greatest distinction of India. I think that regional aspiration is not something to be grudged, it is something to be addressed. So we don't have to grudge it, we have to address it. We don't have to antagonize it, we have to accommodate it. So that should be dictated. Don't grudge, address. Don't antagonize, accommodate. But somewhere down the line, in the course of 50, 60 years, because that will involve another political debate, there were certain considerations which were possibly extraneous considerations. Also, depending on the immediate interests, maybe political or otherwise, somewhere consciously or unconsciously, the regional aspirations were either not adequately addressed or the perception went that they were being suppressed. I will not go into the detail of it. If you study the rise of anti-Rama Rao, I think things will become clear. So these kind of things happened. So therefore, this cooperative federalism is a movement in that direction, where the regional aspirations and the regional thoughts, the regional opinions will not only find a place, a room, as far as the economic dividends or the economic share financially is concerned, but also as their participation. So they have the feeling of esteem that, look here, we are also equal partners. We are not being imposed by the center. And for a country like India, that is important. And I think this goes to the credit of Prime Minister Narendra Modi to have realized this soon after taking over the reins of the government. So I agree with you, and this has to be done very judiciously without grudging it. We cannot have us, because we don't have a homogeneous society like United Kingdom. And we don't regret not having that, because that's our richness. So we have to live together. If we could live as a subcontinent where we also had the part of present Bangladesh as ours, Pakistan as ours, and you know, larger parts of the other areas, I think there's no reason we can't have that kind of arrangement of, again, cooperative federalism and cooperative coexistence at the social level as well. But the bottom line has to be drawn. Unfortunately, in this country, and I said this with a certain degree of sounding little unorthodox, thodi bagawat kar di maine parso. So I said this kind of intellectual jingoism sometimes, you know. There's the message has somewhere gone that there's a premium on anti-India activism. If I say I'm son of my father, it doesn't make news. If I say, try to find out who's my father, it becomes a subject of debate. So challenging the sovereignty of India, we have to draw a bottom line. And the most liberated democracies in the world, including UK and USA, have their bottom lines, which have become part of their national ethos. I was narrating the example of a very senior journalist who used to publish my write-ups. He was running an agency here called Infa, he's no more now, Mr. Inderjeet. He would very fondly narrate an anecdote that after 1965 war, when again Kashmir was in discussion, so there was a press conference with President Johnson, who had taken over after Kennedy, and that issue of so-called referendum and other things came up. And one of the Indian journalists asked him, Mr. President, don't you think USA is also a similar conglomerate of a number of states, some annexed, some acceded? So he said, look here, gentlemen, that's a closed chapter. So even the liberal, so if we have bottom lines, I think that will also ensure discipline. It's like living in a joint family with diverse characteristics, but we follow a bottom line. And I think that is also not happening as easily or as fast as possible, because we are evolving. We are an evolving democracy. 69, 70 years is just infancy in the age of a nation.
Sir, can I know from you, in the issue of national cohesion, the policy of reservation which the country has perpetuated till this time, do you feel that that is supporting national cohesion, or is that in any way a hindrance to cohesion? And if so, it continues, what is the time frame that you foresee?
I don't think I am qualified to answer that question, because there's a lot of political and administrative undertones, and somebody being part of the government should not be actually answering it. But I tend to believe, and I would love to believe, that whatever decision was taken at any given time by those who were at the helm of affairs must have been taken in the best interest of the nation. And whatever is decided in future also will be in the best interest of nation. I think that is the safest response I can give.
I think with that, we'll go on to the vote of thanks. Ma'am, over to you.
Honorable Union Minister, Dr. Jitendra Singh Ji. Honorable Minister of State for Information and Broadcasting, Colonel Rajyavardhan Rathore. Chairman Prasar Bharati, Dr. A. Surya Prakash. Member Personnel, Shri S.C. Panda. Member Finance, Shri Rajiv Singh Ji. Advisor Prasar Bharati, Shri Sunil Arora Ji. And we are honored with the presence of Honorable MP, Shri Tarun Vijay Ji. Esteemed guests, colleagues. We had the privilege of listening to Dr. Jitendra Singh Ji and also going through his speech that was circulated by us earlier. On a subject as complex as cooperative federalism, we had a brilliant and visionary exposition. The subject has been dealt with a perspicacity that speaks volumes of the erudition of Dr. Jitendra Singh. From the constraints that the framers of Constitution faced to the paradigm shift in the policies of the new government, from the new direction given to Niti Aayog, to the humongous task of formulating the GST, the Honorable Union Minister has covered every aspect of reconciling regional aspirations and fostering national cohesion. Dr. Jitendra Singh very kindly accepted our request to deliver the prestigious Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture for this year. Despite his onerous responsibilities of the multiple portfolios that he handles and his extremely busy schedule. On behalf of DGAIR and Prasar Bharati, we express our gratitude to Dr. Jitendra Singh Ji. We would like to thank most heartily Colonel Rajyavardhan Rathore, the Honorable Minister of State for Information and Broadcasting, for his remarks on the significance of Rashtriya Ekta Divas. Interesting facts from our history on the unification of India and the stellar role played by Sardar Patel. Your august presence, sir, is a matter of great pride and inspiration for us. Our sincere thanks to Chairman Prasar Bharati, Dr. A. Surya Prakash, who is always with us in all our ventures. In him, we have a mentor and guide. And we are fortunate to receive his blessings and benefit from his vast experience. We would like to thank CEO Prasar Bharati, who could not be here today, but whose good wishes we have received for this event. Member Personnel, Shri S.C. Panda, Member Finance, Shri Rajiv Singh Ji, have always motivated us to innovate and excel in our role as a public broadcaster. And we would like to acknowledge their guidance. We are grateful to the Secretary, Additional Secretary, and other senior officers of the Ministry of INB for their support. Shri Sunil Arora Ji, Advisor Prasar Bharati, for his kind presence. Our thanks to DGPIB, who has kindly provided us with this venue, and his team that has worked with us to make all the arrangements. We thank our esteemed friends from the press and media who will take the message of this lecture to a wider audience. We express our thanks to DG Doordarshan, DG News Doordarshan, DG News All India Radio for their kind cooperation, and all colleagues who have helped us in organizing this event, colleagues in the Directorate of All India Radio, the PR team, and most of all the team of All India Radio Delhi, led by the DDG Shri Rajiv Shukla. At the end, I would most certainly like to thank the audience for their presence, for their participation, and I would like to make a special mention of students of Sanskriti School, Chanakyapuri, Modern School, Barakhamba Road, the Indian Institute of Mass Communication, World Skills Center, Vivek Vihar, and the Madhubala Institute of Communication and Electronic Media. Thank you all once again.
May I remind members of the media present here that the recording of today's lectures are embargoed till 10:30 p.m. on 31st October. The recording can be heard and it will be broadcast by us on 31st October 2016 at 10 p.m. on our Rajdhani Indraprastha FM Rainbow, FM Gold channels and the National Network of All India Radio. You may listen to this recording of the Honorable Dr. Jitendra Singh wherever you are in India through your sets and web